Welcome to the Shipping Podcast, where you meet interesting maritime professionals sharing their passion for the shipping industry and their everyday job. I am your host. My name is Lena Gothberg. Hello and welcome to the 77th episode of the Shipping Podcast. In this episode, I met with the harbour master of the Port of Gothenburg. Her name is Åsa Tjärnebro. She's also the manager of the harbour master's office. I think this is a great episode. Again, I might be biased. I always love my last episode. But I think this one is great, especially since I got some feedback lately that my previous interviews have been very abstract. Well, this episode isn't. It's very concrete and hands-on. Well, you know me. I couldn't help myself but finding a woman in a part of our industry which is even more male-dominated, I think, than maybe others. And she's on top of things. She knows what she's doing. I think it's the same with almost all women that I know within the maritime industry. They are very alone in their occupation. They are surrounded by men, and they are strong women, and they know their businesses. That's why I'm so supportive of Vista, which is the Women's International Shipping and Trading Association. It's a place for us to meet and to see that there are others in this wonderful line of business called the maritime industry. I met Åsa in her office October 12th, 2017, and this is our conversation.
My name is Åsa Tjärnebro Bergström. I'm the harbour master of Port of Gothenburg. I'm a master mariner, and I've been for the Port of Gothenburg for approximately 9 years now. Actually, just a month ago, I stopped sailing around 20 years ago. So I've been ashore for a very long time.
How did you become a master mariner? How did you start sailing?
Well, actually, my father had a very good friend, and he was a master mariner. He was a tug captain, and he was a very funny guy. A lot of histories and stories, and he was just different to other men that I have met when I was a little girl. I was around 5-6 years. And my father, actually, he invested in one of the tug that this captain had, and they drew timber on the Baltic for a couple of years. And I think that's when I started to think I also would like to be as free and funny guy as this master mariner. Sten Beck, hello, if you hear this.
So you went to school then here in Sweden? Or?
Yes, I did. Well, I started college, the Drift och Underhållsteknik. I'm not sure what the name is in English, but it was the energy program. And it was a separate part that was into shipping, of course, seaman school. And after that, I started sailing as an AB, able seaman, for a couple of years. And then I went to Kalmar, to the Merchant Marine Academy there, and had my education as a master mariner. I took the exam in 92, and then I worked as a second officer and also a chief officer, but mainly in the tankers, chemical tankers.
And when did you decide to come ashore too?
Oh, actually, it wasn't my decision. I got pregnant, so it was a little bit difficult to continue to sail. I tried for a year, but it didn't work out for me. So I went ashore finally, 96, when my daughter was 1 year old.
And started at the port, or...?
Well, no, I had the only job experience I had was on ships. So I didn't really know what I could do as a master mariner ashore. So I just applied for every job that had this, well, ship experience or master mariner experience or whatever. So I applied for approximately 30 jobs. And at that time, I lived just outside Stockholm. And I got a job interview at Chalmers here in Gothenburg, and I got a job as a lecturer and started to work here 97, 1st of January.
Mm-hmm. So you were a teacher, a lecturer.
Yes, but that wasn't really my thing. So I was only there for 6 months, and then I applied for another job, and then it's just build up my experience. And finally, I felt when I started to work at Swedia, with that time the CEO was Eva Hansson, and she became a very good. I really looked up to her. So I was there at Tunsö, at that shipping company, for a couple of years with sea personnel, seagoing stuff. And then I was there for a couple of years. Eva stopped and she handed over it to her husband and her brother. And at that time, I got an offer from DFDS if I could start to work there with a Filipino crew. Because they was in that time was just when you have in Sweden we had took the decision to have this TAP agreement, and that sounds very exciting, of course, and also it was much closer to home. So at that time I was a single mom as well, so the decision wasn't easy, but I think it was a good decision because I got a really good experience with interculture crew and. All that thing around that.
So you've seen the shipping from all different sides.
Yes, I have. So, the knowledge I have is a lot of knowledge, but just a little bit of everything. But it got you the perspective in a way, of course.
I think it's important, especially for young people, to know that the more experience you gain, the better. I mean, you got that in your rucksack or...
yeah.
To the next position you get into. And interesting. I think it's interesting. Yeah. I didn't know that.
But also, I think at that time, when I was younger than I am now, I was not very afraid. I was quite brave or naive. I'm not sure. The difference there.
Might go hand in hand.
I think so too. And... how hard can it be? That was my motto at that time. Today I'm a little bit more careful and thinking twice before I take decisions. But I think you have to be brave just to move on. Actually, you shouldn't be afraid.
But don't you think that we are like that in this business? That's why we like the business.
Yes, I think so too. And the thing here in the port, you can actually... compare it by sailing on a vessel, because you never know how the day would be. And what you can be sure of is that it's not going to be as you had planned. And just it's just the same in the port when you have the wind and the people and the port, etc. So you don't have to improvise all the time, but you should have different solutions for different issues.
Yeah, and I also think most of the people you meet in the maritime industry are open-minded. Otherwise, they won't enjoy working in this industry.
Yeah, that's true. And I also think you should always look into new possibilities and challenges and embrace it, because that is what the shipping sector could grow, actually. You shouldn't be afraid there. Try. You should try.
I agree.
Yeah.
So now you are the harbor master.
Yes.
In the port of Gothenburg. So what do you do then? What is your responsibility?
Well, you can say that, of course, my biggest responsibility is to be the port authority and see that all the bylaws and regulation, etc., it's followed by the ship and all the entrepreneur and everybody who is within the harbor. That's one part, but of course you have different roles. There should be a service provider, and you should really make an effort to see that the vessel can come, lay in, and depart from the port in a safe, efficient, and environmental way. And of course, to be a part in discussions when shipping companies have new buildings ongoing. And of course, we are the biggest port in Scandinavia, but the port facilities are from the 60s. So sometimes the port aren't built to really be able to bring in these larger vessels. And of course, also I'm collaborating, not only me, it's the Harbour Master Office, my personnel, to collaborate with the pilots, with the tug company, with the terminals, and of course, and also the linesmen, etc. So we have a very good port community regarding this question. So I think that's also one of the main thing that you should have good dialogue and good cooperation and discuss things regarding risk analysis or whatever to come to the best solution.
So how many people in your office?
At the Harbour Master Office, well, on the office side, it's me and my deputy, and we also have the security manager and his deputy, and we also have the VTS manager. She is working 50% for the port. And then we have the traffic center, the port control, and there are 5 shift-going personnel, and our inspection launch, MS Hamnen, that are daily working within the port all the time.
So how many?
12.
Okay. And how many ships are coming into the port? Do you count that per day or per year? I don't know. How many calls in Gothenburg?
Well, it depends how you are counting within the statistic. But I have to go with the department here. I don't agree with them. But they say around 6,000 calls every year. So that's the call. But you also have other kind of movements within the port, you know. The ferries over the river, and of course all the barges, all the ship going up for Lake Van. And so, as I said before, it depends how you count.
How is it to be a woman in the shipping industry? I mean, you are a master mariner, and now you're the harbor master. So what is that like, to be a woman?
Well, I guess I've been within the industry for a very long time, since I was 70 years old. So, of course, I have seen the downside to be a woman. But in another hand, it's there all the time. But I don't really think of it. I don't. I'm trying not to. Because in that way, it's a lot of energy going out that way. So I would like to use my energy to my task. Actually,
I agree. I don't think about it either anymore. But then I meet and I hear young women all over the world.
Yes.
They are contacting me and they say, could you please talk a little bit about how do you cope with working in a male-dominated industry? Mm. I would say, do your best. Mm. I would say the same thing to young men.
Yes.
The only way is to do your best, mind your own business and do what you appreciate. Because if you find things interesting and fun, then you would be good at it.
Yeah, actually, when I was younger, of course, I didn't have the enough confidence in myself. So when you are really trying to learn the business and what you should do within your role, of course, you got the confidence as well. So in that way, if you confine in yourself, it doesn't really matter what other people think of you. Because you know, actually, that, well, okay, you can have your opinion, but I know that this was the right thing to do at that time. So, but also I'm thinking of all the women that are joining this industry, and I know they have to struggle in the beginning. But also new nurses, etc., is the same, because you really need to focus on the work and try to find the inner calm and confident in yourself.
Agree. But also I think it's important for our generation of women in the maritime industry to be that, to be visible.
Yes.
Because when I was young and entered this industry, there were no one to look up to. There were no one that could show that, a woman can be harbor master. There were no women for me, unless they had inherited a shipping company or something like that.
Mm.
So that's why it's important to me to be visible.
Mm. Yeah, I think that's totally true, what you're saying. Because within your position, of course, hopefully, younger women could see it. It's possible. It's not a big deal. If she could do it, I can do it. So, of course, when I really would like to be a good role model for the young women within the industry.
I think you are. You're just not aware of it.
And of course, I know I have, well, a couple of colleagues that also are harbor master. Carita in Kokkola, she's a harbor master. And then we have an harbor master in Amsterdam. That's also, she's a woman. And Mariehamn, Åland. So Carita, the harbor master in Kokkola, we have a lot of common things. So if you really need to feel that I need to talk to someone, I have her, or, well, I have other people as well, but she's the closest one that could understand my, well, what I'm struggling with at the moment.
So there are three in Europe, or is that worldwide, or do you know how many women there are?
No, not worldwide, actually. I don't think it's that many, but in Europe we are four.
So which one is? Kokkola, Mariehamn, Gothenburg and...
Amsterdam.
Yeah.
That's so good.
Yeah, yeah. Really? Maybe there need to be more, I don't know. How do you see the future for shipping then? I know that there are so many things. You are innovating and you are doing planning for the future, but how do you see shipping in the future?
Well, I think everything is happening really, really fast at the moment. And I think if you start with the port facilities, I think the main challenge is to adapt the port facilities with new building and LNG and maybe also electricity shore connection, and also all the rules and regulation for the environment. It's a lot of things that happening at the same time, and I think that's a challenge to meet up with that, so you could really see yourself as a sustainable port. And also the new building vessel, maybe they're not getting much longer, but they're going to get a little bit more wider. And do we have the fairways to meet up with that? And this ultra container large vessel, it's also a challenge, of course, to bring them in fully loaded. That's not going to happen in Gothenburg today, but hopefully tomorrow, because it's really, really important. Otherwise, if you look at the autonomous ships, I don't know much about that, actually, but I think it's quite thrilling to see what's going to happen with that. And also all the kind of, well, the LNG propulsion, also the methanol, maybe the battery will come on the vessel, etc. So it's a lot of things that's going to happen, and you really need to be prepared, I guess, for the future.
Do you think that the port, I mean, I can see and hear the shipping companies or the provider to the industry talking about autonomous ships and digitalization and all of that. Is the port involved in what they are talking about? Are you collaborating?
Well, I guess it's different department doing different things within the Port Authority. And I know this splendid lighthouse, for example, that are inviting for all that new things that probably will be our future. I think we should actually participate more in that.
Yeah, because I think the ship owners and the shipping, they could develop anything they want, but if there is no port to greet them, to take care of the cargo, I mean, the main thing is to transport cargo. So it comes from one shore and it should be to another shore.
Yeah,
and in between there is a ship.
Yes, of course. And it's good that you mention it, because I know, for example, a good example of collaboration is within the energy port, where they have good discussions with the ship owners at Doense, for example, Furutank and Tärntank, that they were going over to LNG to have the facility to for that vessel to take bunker, for example. And that's an example of collaboration. Well, I have a colleague in the Netherlands, for example. He always say, first thing first, you need to have the statical validated nautical information on place before you can start to develop dynamic systems for vessels. Because we all know that within, I would say, all the ports, if you don't have the real proper information, you will always lose time. And time is money. And if you don't have proper information regarding the depth at the berth, for example, the ship owner could lose a lot of money because you cannot take fully loaded or whatever. So I think that the communication and information flow within a port need to be improved. And I think I'm not the only one that thinks so. It's a lot of ports within the in Europe and all over the world that see this is a huge problem because you have a lot of different actors. For example, you have Swedish Maritime Administration, you have a transport agency, you have the terminals, tug companies that are private, linesmen that are private, etc. And all the communication and information within a call needs to be provided to all these stakeholders. And that's a challenge because today it's done by email, by a telephone, by not fax any longer. I do hope not. Maybe to the custom, I'm not sure. But also by radio, of course. And if you have a lot of stakeholders within a call, of course, the information will be different regarding to who you are speaking to. And that's why I think we really need a system that are transparent to all the stakeholders. Maybe like Port CDM, but we also have a project in the Netherlands that IHMA are standing behind, the Pronto and the Avanti. Avanti is statical nautical information and Pronto is the dynamic part within that. So we really need to know where you are within the nautical chain when a vessel call. And we need to know the timestamps, ETA, the definition of an ETA, is it when pilot are boarding or ETA on a berth? And sometimes, actually, you cannot believe it, but it is different. And that could also make a lot of misunderstandings within the chain and in the end, losing time.
So does the regulators keep up with all the developments that are happening right now?
My point of view, no, because everything is happening very fast and the regulators are not moving as fast as maybe they have to do. Well, it's just my thought that there are a lot of bureaucracy. Well, a lot of people that need to discuss. I can understand the way of doing it because you need to have, for example, IMO, all the international things and all country have different views of what's important. And also sometimes with the EU directives, for example, different nations within the EU are interpreted in different ways. And in that case, you doesn't really have a regulation that are the same in different nations within the EU because the nation are interpreting the EU directive in different ways. For example, waste, sludge. And that's causing a lot of problem for the ports.
So in a way, it would be a problem for you as a Swedish harbour master to be a harbour master in, let's say, Italy or Holland, or because they are having a different view on regulations or?
No, not really. I think when I'm meeting my colleagues within in Europe or international way, I do feel that we have the same issues that we have to struggle with or challenges. So no, not in that way, because the Port Authority, we don't compete to each other, actually.
No, of course not.
Maybe it's different for the marketing department, for example. But all the port authorities are looking very different depending on which country you're coming to. So in Sweden, we have in one way, or this port is looking like this, but the other ports within Sweden, the port authorities still have the terminals, for example, and then you have private ports. So it looks different. But I think the port authority within Europe, I do feel that we have the same issues and the same problem, and well, the agenda looks the same.
So it's the regulators who are representatives of the nations that are sitting around a table in IMO that has a different opinion than the port authorities. Okay, I get it. I'm sorry. Confusing.
Oh, sorry. Thank you.
No problem. I want to understand that so we can explain it to the rest of the world. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
The shipping industry is often looked upon like the hidden industry. No one knows about us. What do you think we can do about that?
I do understand what you're meaning with that. And what 20 years ago, I would say, stop recruiting within your own line. You have to take in people from other industries to bring in new ideas, etc. And I think the shipping industry really have done that. They're not recruiting a person like me, the master mariner, to do the personnel thing. You take a proper educated person that handles that. And I think that's good. And I think we should do that more, maybe. Of course, you need the experience and the competence from the shipping industry, but in some key positions, you need to bring in new blood.
Yeah, but how do we reach them? My theory is that we in the maritime industry, or in the shipping industry, we talk to each other about shipping because we love shipping.
Mm.
But who else do we talk to?
Mm.
How do we find this HR people that should be recruited, taking care of the staff and personnel or things like that? And how do we find them if we don't talk about ourselves to them?
But maybe it looks different in different countries. For example, in Norway, I don't think that it's a problem to recruit people because the country, well, Norway really embrace the shipping industry. In Sweden, maybe not the same culture here in Sweden. Oh, they are so difficult. I got that feeling sometimes. And maybe also Denmark are embracing the shipping industry. And maybe the politicians in Sweden really need to understand that we have a shipping industry. To have on their agenda that the shipping industry really can compete with other countries on the same condition. And if the politicians are lifting up the shipping industry, of course, it will be, it have to come from the above, I guess. This is a really important industry for Sweden. 90% of our import comes in with vessels or ships. It's, you need to lift it.
Yeah. I think we also need to be a bit more open.
Yeah.
And to be available. And we can tell them what we contribute with, the better for the entire nation, in a way.
Yeah.
But I meet people from all over the world, and I think that it's a common problem.
Mm.
Because I think the shipping industry, they are doing their business. They're minding their business. And some of the people do not really realize how cool they are and how interesting their jobs are and so on. So they don't tell anyone, and they don't tell to the younger people. And not to the politicians either. So if the only thing that they can see, a politician or young people, the next generation, is a grounding because someone was drunk on board, or if they only see oil spill, or if they only see, I don't know, whenever the shipping industry is on the top again, when they see people earning money on it, if that is the only picture they get, who are we then?
Yeah, but it's also important to really, well, we got a lot of offers to, could you please come and talk at the Rotary Club, or could you please come and talk at the school, etc. And I think we should do that more, because this part of the shipping industry, the ports and the ships and, well, the whole thing around it, it's really, really interesting. And you always have a very good audience when you're speaking about this. And maybe we should do that more within the shipping industry. Start with the youngest.
Yeah, I agree. And I can see it, you know, when we have had these big container vessels calling in the port of Gothenburg, there is a queue of people.
Yeah, they love it. They are totally love it. And I think that's also a good gesture with the port of Gothenburg, that we have to do something. We need to offer the common,
the general public. System.
Yeah, yeah, to see it for themselves.
It's, I don't know if that's tradition in our city or whatever it is, but people are queuing up as soon as there is a possibility to go on board a ship or to see something in the port. And I think you're doing a great job, because you have been taking people on smaller boats to go out and see it from the sea as well.
Yeah, and that's the only way to do it right now, because due to all the security regulation, you cannot bring them into the terminal, but still on the seaside you're able to do it. And it's really important to, especially in the city, to because it's the citizen that really own the port of Gothenburg. You can say that in a way. And it's really important because in within the region here, I think the port really generates around 22,000
jobs.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. And a lot of people doesn't know that, that no. you are such a big employer and that you are actually creating jobs for so many people.
Yes. Not only in the region, but also in the whole nation, in the whole Sweden.
Yeah. More shipping to the people, that's my...
Yes, more shipping to the people. And yeah, that's really, really important to understand also that we are a peninsula because all the import, export, actually, it's done by ships.
Yeah, we've got the longest coastline in EU.
Yeah.
We know that, but I'm not quite sure how many of the politicians that knows that.
No.
So... who would you be interesting in listening to in the shipping podcast? Who do you think I should meet the next?
Actually, I would like to hear more about Olaf Merk.
Yeah, he's on my target list.
Yeah.
And he keeps avoiding me, so...
Oh, wow. Oh.
He's now on the blacklist of my target list. I would love to sit down with Olaf. And,
yeah.
And I've been trying to... I understand he travels to Gothenburg now again. I love his blog. I think it's so great.
Yes.
He's writing so many interesting stuff on his blog.
Mm.
Yeah. I'll try and catch him next time he just passes by.
Great, Lena. Do that.
Thank you very much, Åsa, for taking the time.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you, Åsa. Thank you for sharing. I think your job sounds very interesting. Good luck with the developments. You know that I will be following this very closely. It's a new year, and I've been spending some time thinking about how I can lift this podcast to the next level. I don't know how much you as a listener can take when it comes to changes, but I will have to test my tribe, or nothing will happen. So I'm thinking about maybe some new intro music. Do I have any listeners that could help me with that? Are there any musicians out there? I don't know, what should it sound like? I thought when I chose this intro music that I'm using now and have been using for 2.5 years, that it's a bit pepping. It's like a pep music to me, anyhow. I'm thinking about outsourcing the editing of the show. Is there anyone out there who knows anything about that? Or should I try and solve that through my new network within the podcasting industry? I don't know. I'm thinking of changing my tech, both the editorial side, but also the microphone side. Anyone has got any ideas about that? I'm also updating the marketing plan. Do I have any volunteers who wants to help me out? I've got so many ideas and thoughts in my head. If you look back, I've built this from nothing. I've been doing this for 2.5 years. I have been educating myself. I have done so many things to learn more and to become that expert, which I always aim for whatever I do. And the more I have learned about how things are done differently in other industries, when it comes to marketing, digital online communication, podcasting, printed media, ads, newspapers, I've learned so much and I have realized that the shipping industry is old-fashioned in many ways and underdeveloped. We're always cutting edge when it comes to the ships, but there are so many other areas where we need to do some changes. It has started, the digitalization has started some processes and things that are changing, whether we like it or not. We will become more transparent. We will be more like the other parts of the supply chain. We will start building that brand that I am always nagging so much about. But we also have to update other parts of our industry because there are people out there using us in a way that shouldn't be allowed. I love this industry. If anyone is doubting that, please know that I love the maritime industry and the people that I meet there. That is why I'm continuing. But I'm changing the concept. Now that you have got a little bit acquainted with what you can do, I will show you more, I promise you. Feedback. I love feedback. You know that. Please email me at hello@shippingpodcast.com or tweet me or post in social media. I am following you. I read what you write and I'm so pleased that I've got that connection with you. The next episode is also about the port and the digitalization of what's happening in a port. So, until the next time, from me to you, over and out. Thank you for listening to the Shipping Podcast. Don't forget to tell everyone that you meet that there is a Shipping Podcast available and that they should download it and listen to the maritime professionals who are sharing their passion for the shipping industry.